Yeah, it's all right. I call that the foyer. That's the foyer church. We have all kind of churches going on in this building. The lobbyist. Are y'all the lobbyist? Praise the Lord. What's up, Marcus? How you doing, bud? Let's go. Good to see you. What you doing here? We'll talk about it later. Okay. All right. All right, so here we go. Announcements, just letting you know that any offering given tonight or Sunday will go to Sister Rhonda. So if you want to give toward the janitorial offering for this Sunday, being the last Sunday, ending of spring, summer, heading into fall, it's crazy. I can't believe you. Oh, yeah, I love fall. I love the weather, but, man, just to think that it's gone by that quick, but it has. So if you want to help toward that, I know that will be greatly appreciated, anything that you can do to help with that. So September 1st is right around the corner, and there's an outreach that's going to be taking place. You can see Tasha. She generally works on Wednesday nights, but if you're interested in helping with that outreach, she's partnering with Providence Baptist Church up in Uptown Lincolnton, and they've got a team of folks that are going to be doing some outreach. So if you'd like to help with that, you can see her on Sunday. She can tell you more about that. All right, there's the nursery ministry schedule. Man, y'all got nursery Sunday. What's the deal? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. I want to remember Tony Wall, who's dealing with cancer and is undergoing treatment. So remember Tony, if you will. Amy Cushman, who's also dealing with cancer. I don't see Sheila. I was going to see what's going on with Ronnie. He had to go in and get a blood transfusion this past week. He lost some blood through his treatments, and they had to give him some blood this week. So remember, continue to remember Ronnie, if you will. He did finish his treatments, though, if you didn't know that from Sunday. He got through all his treatments, his radiation and stuff, got to ring the bell. And so they're just trusting they got everything. So just continue to remember Ronnie, if you will. Odell Hester, who's dealing with cancer. Arthur Wright, who's also dealing with cancer. Edwin Huffman, waiting a parole board decision, so remember that, if you will. Caroline Barnett is dealing with some high blood pressure, so remember this. Madison, how's Madison? Salvation. Still dealing with a lot of pain? Okay. All right. Remember Shirley Goodson. This is Gina Bumgarner's mom, who's dealing with COPD. Marcus, it's good to see you, Marcus. We got you on the list up here, buddy. But continue to pray for Marcus. God continue to do a work in his life. Tommy. Okay. Thank the Lord she's starting a job. So remember Tommy. Continue to remember my dad. I talked with him today. He's supposed to be sitting at home in a recliner or something, keeping his leg up. And I said, what are you doing? Oh, I got this work I got to go do. I said, Dad? He said, you know I'm hard-headed. I said, yeah, that's just something else to pray for. But remember my dad, if you will, as he's dealing with these, it's more than badly bruised. It's busted blood vessels in his leg, and he's on blood thinner. So so remember him. And my family tells me all the time that the nut doesn't fall too far from the tree. So I'm just as hard-headed, but pray for my dad, if you will. Jeff Caldwell is also dealing with cancer. Rick Smith dealing with cancer. Lane is actually traveling to Korea. He's going over there with his taekwondo group. And so I remember Lane, if you will, as he's traveling. Got an update on Don Turner, Debbie? Yeah, check your phone, Trace. Okay. All right. Set a schedule for tomorrow. I.B. Williams is husband of one of our board members for the CPC, Cynthia. He's been having some chest pains, and they've been giving him Gas X trying to get rid of the pain. Kind of find out he had a 90% blockage, and they've got to do open heart surgery. How many? Three or four. Okay. So remember IB, if you will. He's got a lung issue that they've been trying to work through to go to get to this point to do the surgery. So if they've got it scheduled for tomorrow, I'm assuming that'd be at Fry. Yeah. So remember IB, and remember Cynthia, that God would just touch them through this. Vernon Allen, my Uncle Lynn, all these dealing with cancer. Continue to remember Taylor, she's been working through these seizures and figuring out what's going on there. Brenda, you got an update on your granddaughter, Tabitha? Okay. All right. So continue to remember Tabitha, if you will. Caroline Keener, praying for this little baby. He's dealing with some heart problems. Roger Franklin, he's doing better, ain't he? Or is he still dealing with this pneumonia? Anybody know? Yeah, that's an old one. We got some old ones on there. We do need to pray for Mike McFarland, though. He's battling a day at a time. He's not able to do much. He's sleeping a lot. And just they've already got palliative care that's come into the home. So they're just praying that the Lord would turn this situation around. So pray for Mike McFarland, that God would minister him and Angie, his wife, and all the girls. That God would just minister them and strengthen them through this time. So pray for them, if you will. That God would move in their lives in a special way. God's able. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together and ask God to have his way. Anything else before we pray? Yes, ma'am. What'd you say her name was again? Melinda Backstrom. We need to. You had told me this. Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay, Melinda Backstrom. Cyst on her ovaries. Okay. She's got to have a hysterectomy, babe. All right. So remember this. Anyone else before we pray? Yes, ma'am. I'll take those.
She called and told me that she was in pain and that she was at the hospital and that she was hurting and that she was scared. And she asked me, would I pray with her? And of course, I was like, yes, I was excited, you know. And so I prayed with her, and I had just been studying about in 2 Timothy, where God says he doesn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and sound mind for myself. I didn't know that it would also be for her. So that was amazing. Well, we said prayer, we hung up, and she called me back moments later, and she says, Sissy, they're rushing me. She calls me Sissy. She's like, they're rushing me back to the OR. The baby's heart rate was dropping. And she's only, I think she was like 3 weeks early. But I said, Kayla, I said, just listen to me. We're going to pray, okay? And I immediately started praying with her. And after I got on the phone with her, I just felt like I needed to pray more. So I called Tabitha, and we prayed together. And the doctors come and find out. The doctors said that had she not been there, that they both would have died. But praise God, like, both of them came through great. The baby's healthy. It's small, but it's healthy. And as I don't know if everyone knows, but my sister's on methadone. And so she's an addict, and so they monitor her throughout the pregnancy. But the baby, on top of being okay and God taking care of this baby, it also has no signs of withdrawals. So
praise the Lord for that. Amen. That was good. Yes, Nancy. Yeah. This is your coworker, right? You will, yeah, okay. So Amy Cushman got some tests, testing coming up. Praise God. Two Sundays ago, you was preaching. Hey, that anointing will do it. It'll do it every time, bro. I'm telling you right now. Praise God. That's why two Sundays ago, he was preaching the word. He sent his word, and it healed them. Something about the word of the Lord. Amen? Amen. Man, I tell you what, I am homesick. I don't know about you, but I'm homesick. Man, I wish the Lord would just come on and take us home. You know, I've gotten back into a bad habit. I've started reading the news, and I'm homesick. That's all I can tell you. I'm just anticipating his return. We talked last Wednesday night about the birth of this man child in Revelation 12. We're going to pray. But we're still looking at this prophetical review of the church as it's going through this 12th chapter. And we're going to talk today about the woman as she fled into the wilderness. But, man, I'm telling you, I don't sing it, but there's that old song, I've never been this homesick before. I can see the bright light shining. I can see my father standing by the door. Man, I'm telling you, I'm ready for him to come and take us home. Amen. And I don't believe it's going to be much longer. And when I think about these scriptures that we're going to go through tonight, I think about the fact that, first and foremost, by Revelation 12, the church is gone. We're in the presence of God, enjoying the marriage supper of the Lamb and just enjoying his glory and presence. And you're studying now basically what's going on during that tribulation period. But this particular chapter kind of steps back a little bit and deals with the issues of the birth of Christ, the protection of the church, Israel, the 144,000 Jews. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. But you look at all this stuff and you think to yourself, wow, man, God, you're so good and so faithful to do what you said you would do and to bring it to pass right before our eyes. If nothing else, through these first 12 chapters of Revelation, I have come to a deeper appreciation of the sovereignty of God. The book of Revelation, I'm telling you, it scared me for a long time. It's hard material to deal with. And I thank God for great men that have done great studies and help you get insight and things like that. But, man, I'm telling you, when you look at the book of Revelation and watch God, even the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation, how they coincide with one another, you see nothing more than the sovereignty of God, how God is overseeing everything that's happening and everything that's transpiring, and he's bringing his plan to pass. Now, that's encouraging on two different fronts. Number one, in the grand scheme of things, that God's got all this under control, but in a smaller scheme of things, he's got my life under control. As you've heard me say many times, if he called the end from the beginning and he's organized and orchestrated my life, his sovereignty over not just the big picture, but even the things of me and what's going on in my life, what's going on in your life, God's got these things ordered out, and he knows what he's doing. And he's faithful because he promised. And he'll do what he said he would do. So when we look at these lists, and we're at two pages right now. We were at a page for a while, but we're at two pages now. And you think about all these folks dealing with cancer, and you're dealing with all these sicknesses and disorders and heart issues and all this stuff. Man, I don't fret, because none of this caught God by surprise. And he's more than able. Even when you aren't having a healing service, he's able to heal. Amen. Because there's power. And his anointing, his strength, the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, God can do it. He can move into a womb and protect a baby from drugs. Come on, y'all. I mean, he can do the impossible. And we give God praise for that. When you're not even asking him to do something, he just says, just because I love you, I'm going to go ahead and take care of that problem for you, because I know it's irritating. Just down to the smallest, minute of details. He's a good, faithful God. Amen? And he orchestrates and works everything out. And I could stand here for the next 4 hours and just tell you in the last 3 weeks how God's lined one thing right after the other and just help things to fall into place. He's a faithful God. If you want to hear it, call me tonight while I'm driving, and I'll talk to you 4 hours about his faithfulness. But I'm just telling you, he's a faithful God. He's a good God. Amen? Amen. Can we just talk to him just a moment before we get any further in this service? Just ask God to have his way in these needs and requests. God's faithful to do it. We need to ask him. We have not because we ask not. We just need to ask him. Amen? So let's pray. Father, we love you so much. Thank you for this opportunity once again to come into your house and to glean from your word and to hear your voice and to just be encouraged, God. This is encouragement to me in this midweek service, just to say, you know what? You fought these last couple of days. You're coming out of warfare and coming out of those times of just trial and even triumph, God. And you bring us to this moment right now just to encourage us a little bit more, to hang on, God, just to keep pressing on. God, this is not just by time. This is not time that we just need to come in and, you know, come and sit and say that we did it. But God, just to come and glean from the fellowship of the brothers and sisters of Christ, to encourage one another, to hear words of praise and words of prayer. And so, God, we've come tonight knowing and trusting and believing, God, that what we ask of you, you hear and that you answer. And just like you told the prophet Jeremiah, if we call unto you and ask of you, God, that you would show us great mighty things that we know not of. And so, God, that's what we ask for every person on this list, every name that's been called, every situation, God, that's up here, every hand that was raised across this room, everything that's been represented. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that your will be perfected and you do what you said you would do. Father, I give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for what's about to be accomplished. I give you all the glory for it. I thank you, Lord, that you're moving in cancer. I thank you, Lord, that you're protecting babies. I thank you, God, that you're taking aggravating things off of eyes, God, how you touch Roger. I thank you, God, that you're moving in our families, God, our children, our even the grandchildren that are represented in this room. God, I thank you that you're a protector and a waymaker. We cannot thank you enough for the great things that you've done. God, you've been faithful. And Lord, as the Apostle John prayed, I pray even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Call us home. Help us, God, to be rapture ready when you do call us home. Search our hearts and know our minds and our thoughts, God. If there's anything that is displeasing to you in our lives, I pray, God, that you'd forgive us and cleanse us. Help us to be all we're called to be for your glory and for the kingdom while we're here on this earth. Help us to continue to persevere until that midnight cry comes. God, we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor for these things. And we ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. If you want to grab your Bibles and turn with me to Revelation chapter 12. And as you're turning there, let me just get something off my heart here for just a moment. Worship with me as I sing. I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call at the midnight cry. We'll be going home. Thank you, Lord. I look around me. I see prophecies fulfilling everywhere. Signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see the Father saying, Son, go get my children. And at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. When Jesus sets down on a cloud to call his children, the dead in Christ shall
shall be quickly changed. At the midnight cry, we'll be going home.
Shelly, I'm homesick, church.
I look around me, I see prophecies fulfilling everywhere. Signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see my Father saying, son, go get my children. Yeah. Oh, at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise. When Jesus steps out in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed. Midnight cry. Oh, at the midnight cry. Oh, at the midnight cry. When Jesus steps out. Dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed.
Man, I'm telling you, I can't wait to see him. Amen. Amen. Revelation chapter 12. We're just going to jump right in. Just very quickly, just a quick overview of last week's just a few scriptures, and then we're going to jump right into this week. We're going to back up to verse 5, where we were at last week. Revelation chapter 12, verse 5. The Bible says, she bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. So we see here in this particular verse of scripture that this child is a male child, the Old Testament church that ushered in the birth of Jesus Christ. We talked about that last week. This male child, this child, the Bible said, is a shepherd to all nations. He's going to rule all nations with a rod of iron. It's the same as the stone that was cut out of the mountain without hands. Look at Daniel chapter 2, 44 and 45. In those days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, and the silver, and the gold, the great God who has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure. So we see here this stone that was not made by hands. It was not made from man-made principles. It was made by God the Father himself. He brought Jesus Christ to this earth, conceived of the Holy Ghost through this young virgin Mary. God brought his plan to purpose, if you will. He brought it into pass, and the dream was certain, and the interpretation was sure. God said, I'm going to do what I said I was going to do. The kingdoms of the earth will be given to Christ. He will shepherd them with a rod of iron, as it tells us in Revelation chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. The Bible said the seventh angel sounded. There were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And 24 elders who sat before God on their thrones fell on their faces and worshiped God. The nations were angry, and your wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that you should reward your servants, the prophets and the saints, and those who fear your name, small and great, and should destroy those who destroy the earth. Then the temple of God was opened in heaven, and the ark of his covenant was seen in his temple, and there were lightnings and noises, thunderings and earthquake and great hail. So we see that what God did when this kingdom was given to Christ, that he ruled it with a rod of iron. He ruled it with authority. He ruled it with distinction, because they understood that he was the king above all kings, the Lord above all lords, that he's going to do what God has purposed him to do. This blessed event will occur at the end of the great tribulation when this seventh trumpet is sounded. The dragon wants to rule also. Satan wants to set up his kingdom, if you will. Christ is also going to be a ruler, and he's going to oppose Christ. And this is why he gives the world to the Antichrist. Christ is the reign, talking about Satan, gave it to the Antichrist. But Christ is the reign with irresistible authority and power over the whole world. As John said, all nations. God is going to set Jesus up again with a kingdom that will not be destroyed. A kingdom that will not be destroyed. So there's a promise that's given to the church in Thyatira that if they could be co-sharers with Christ in this ruling, if they overcame. Revelation chapter 2, 26 and 27. He said, and he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations. Remember that God gives Jesus power to rule all the nations with a rod of iron. And Jesus says to the church, if you overcome, I'm going to give you power to rule the nations. And he said, he shall rule with them with a rod of iron. They shall be dashed to pieces like the potter's vessels, and as I also have received from my Father. So we see that this same promise is unto us. The second portion of chapter 5, the Bible said the ascension of the Messiah, that the child was caught up unto God and to his throne. This verse of scripture has reference, of course, to the ascension of Jesus Christ in Mark 16 and 19. The Bible tells, so then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. The book of Luke also records it. The book of Acts also records it. And the Bible said that he's going to come again. If you'll go to Acts chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, he says, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Now listen, folks, that's the assurance that I have. That's the hope that I have, is that not only did he ascend to the Father and he's interceding for me up there, but the hope is that he's coming again. Listen, folks, Paul put it this way in his context. He said, if Christ be not risen, then what we do is in vain. Well, what we do is in vain if Christ ain't coming back. In his context, he was preaching salvation to those that were lost. But in our context, in this modern day church, if Christ is not coming back, then we have no hope. But the hope that I have is what the angels declared here, is that he is coming back again in like manner. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. So not only did Jesus declare it, but the angel even declared it, that he was coming again in like manner. And so he's going to come just like he said he would. Now let's go to the sixth verse. That was in about 5 minutes what I preached last week in 45. So we did good. Verse 6. The Bible said, then the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Look at this verse. Again, you cannot question the sovereignty of God. And when you read this verse, you cannot question the hand of God and the provision of God. God said, I prepared this place for her in this wilderness that she should be fed there. When I read this, the first thing that pops on my mind is how Elijah was sustained by the brook. How that God sent the ravens in with the meat, and then even in the wilderness, how that God prepared him even in the wilderness, how God kept him in the midst of a famine. I don't care where you are. I don't care what you're dealing with. God knows where you're at. God knows what you have need of. And my God is a God that loves you so much that he's going to prepare you and keep you and overshadow you and protect you every single time. God led her to this wilderness, and in this place that was prepared for her by God. Think about this for a moment. She's being driven into the wilderness, but God was already in the wilderness making preparations. We shun the wilderness experience. But in the wilderness experience, God will sustain you. Even with the Israelites, with Moses, was murmuring and complaining and carrying on in that wilderness experience, God was still there as a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. God was still there giving water from a rock. God was still there sending manna, and when they begged for meat, he sent them quail. God was, even in the wilderness experience, God was preparing and going before them, and he does the same thing for you and I, and he's going to do the same thing for the woman that will be driven into the wilderness. He prepared that place for her. That when she got there, that they should feed her. The preparation wasn't just the place, but the people in the place. I'm not real sure who they are, but there's a they. There's a they there that God said, they're going to be there, and their purpose is to feed you. What a God, folks. What a powerful picture of God's provision and God's timing. God knows exactly what he's doing. So in this particular ascension of the man-child, and I had to back up a little bit from last week to kind of get to where we need to understand. There's a little gap there between verse 5 and verse 6. And most people look at this gap, if you will, as the grace dispensation or the time that we're living in. It is that hidden mystery of God, the inclusion of the Gentiles as heirs of salvation. Thank God that we're a part of that. So you're in that grace dispensation, if you will. This gap is the same as that between the 69th and the 70th week of Daniel's 70 weeks of years in Daniel chapter 9, verses 20 through 27. Look at these verses. Now, while I was speaking, praying, and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God, yes, while I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, reached me about the time of the evening offering. And he informed me and talked to me and said, O Daniel, I have now come forth to give you skill to understand. At the beginning of your supplications, the command went out, and I have come to tell you, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider the matter and understand the vision. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command man to restore and build Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall, even in troublesome times. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the Prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to the sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. So here we see in this particular part of what Daniel's seeing, he's seeing a vision of those 70 weeks, and there's a gap, if you will, between that 69th week, that 70th week, because in that part, God is bringing as many Gentiles that will receive him, he's bringing them unto the into the gospel. He's helping them to understand grace and mercy that God has extended this to them. And so there's this gap that takes place between the ascension of Jesus Christ. The church really steps up onto the forefront, and God begins to use the church in a powerful way. Now, we know in that time period, this is where we're at, which I believe we're at the end of. So we're in that end of that particular church time, that particular age, however you want to look at it. We're at the end of that particular time, but at this particular end right now, God is going to prepare a place for us to take us and feed us those that are in the tribulation period that are sealed, these 144,000 Jews that are sealed, God has a place prepared for them because they're going to be protected. At this whole time, God's got his fingerprints on everything that's going on. It would be easy in these trials and tribulations and struggles and all this stuff to give the devil credit, but God's got his fingerprint on everything that's going on. He put the plan in word way back in Daniel's day, and now we're beginning to see it come to pass. In this particular Daniel scripture, we see where God talks about the Antichrist and the rising of him, the falling of the Messiah, and how that all this stuff, and right up to the end, he's going to have rule and reign. But then we also understand from prior Daniel scriptures that I read that he said God's going to set up his kingdom. And when he does, it'll be a kingdom that will not be destroyed. So Messiah is going to reign in the place that God calls us. So we got this inclusion of the Gentiles as the heir of salvation, this 69th and 70th week. So these 1,260 days, or 3.5 years, that are mentioned in this verse, they're parallel to the ministry of the two witnesses. Look at Revelation chapter 11, verse 3. He said, I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. So all this is happening is parallel with the witnesses. This woman clothed is now isolated into the wilderness where God has prepared that place, but God's witnesses are still there testifying of God's glory. There are people that will tell you that God just pulls himself back for that 7 years. But again, God's fingerprints are on everything that's going on. And the beauty of it is that even in the midst of tribulation, God's still got people that are going to testify of his word and his glory. Amen. Why? I was listening to a little video clip of Ray H. Hughes. If you've been in the Church of God, about 5, 10, 15, 20 years or so, you probably have heard that name. If you haven't, then you've missed a great man of God, great preacher. But I was listening to a little video clip, and he was talking about how that God's not willing that any man should perish, and he was going on about how, you know, that people that come to Jesus, they don't leave the same, and how that God just turns their life around and does these magnificent things in their life. Listen, I believe that God does what he does even through the tribulation, because even in that, God is still gracious, God is still merciful, God's still extending his salvation to people that accept him and receive him. I don't believe for a moment that God has pulled back and that God will pull back the reins. I still believe that God's going to reach into the hearts of people, and if people are called on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. I believe that. I believe that's why his word's still going forth. They'll hear his word, they'll be convicted of his word, by his word, and they'll turn their life over to Christ, and those people will be a part of the redeemed. I believe that. I believe that God's going to do that. Why? Why do I believe that? Because this tribulation period is not about humanity, it's about the devil. God's plan for humanity does not change. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all come to everlasting life. Now listen, I've said it before and I'll say it again. I don't want to go that route. I don't want the trumpet of God sound and me sitting here looking around going, uh-oh. This is the easiest route possible. Now some people like to take the scenic route when they go on little trips. Some people like to go, Brother Jim will take you on 15-mile-an-hour curves up in the mountains so that you can see the scenic route. Me, I prefer the interstate. Just get me there as quick as I can get there and let me see what I want to see. And if I see it, great. If not, just get me there. That's the way I feel about heaven. Put me on the interstate that's going there. You say, is there an interstate? Listen, my Bible tells me there's a highway. Come on now. He didn't say no curvy back mountain, curvy road. He said there's a highway that leadeth up there, and it's a highway of holiness that leads into the presence of God. That's the place I want to go. I don't want to bicycle up there. I don't want to jog up there. I want to get me some kind of fancy Cadillac with some air conditioning and some room service and ride the highway. Are you with me? That's the place that I'm at. I don't want to beat around the bush. I want to go that way. But there are going to be those that reject the gospel leading up to, but then God's still going to extend the gospel through these two witnesses They're still going to preach it, proclaim it, and God's even going to use them in a powerful way. And we've talked about that already, so I'm not going to get into witnesses again. But to understand this, that these women, that this woman that's talked about here in verse 6, that she's very possibly, some people say it's the 144,000 Jews that are protected during the tribulation, the ceiling of these 144,000 Jews. We talked about it in Revelation chapter 7, verses 4 through 8. He said, I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. Of the tribe of Judah, of the tribe of Reuben, of the tribe of Gad, all these 12,000. We're going to just kind of bypass that just a moment. But all 12 tribes have 12,000 representatives, and they're all sealed in that particular time. And so we see this sealing that takes place. It's representation of all the tribes of Israel, and they're going to be preserved from Antichrist slaughter during this time. To say definitely that there is a connection between these two events, it's not really possible. In any case, the Antichrist will try to destroy Israel when he breaks his covenant of peace with him that he's going to make with her. Daniel chapter 9, verse 27 is a very important verse of scripture that you need to remember. We've been over it several times, and we'll do it again. But in the middle of that covenant, in the middle of that 70 weeks, in the middle of the tribulation, he breaks his covenant with Israel. And this is what the verse says. He's going to confirm that covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Basically, he's letting them live in peace, but in that last 3.5 years, it's destruction. They cry peace, peace, and sudden destruction comes. He breaks that covenant with them. In the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, the Antichrist, even until the consummation, which is determined, is poured out on the desolate. So what Daniel sees here is this rejection of the covenant that the Antichrist makes with Israel, and then God seals them and protects them and puts them in a place because he already knows that this is going to happen. Listen, just like he already knew that Adam and Eve would bite the Old Testament forbidden fruit, he had a plan. Amen. He already had a plan. He already had this war with Satan prior to all that coming to pass. Satan had already risen up in pride, and God had already cast him out. And Jesus said, I was there. I beheld him when he fell like lightning. God knows what he's doing. He's sovereign. Stuff like this just doesn't happen. God brings it to pass in his time, in his way, for his glory. So we see all this parallel that's taking place. So there is a parallel between Romans chapter 12, verse 6. Look at Romans 12, verse 6. The woman fled in the wilderness where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Now look at Revelation 12 and 14. But the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and a times and a half a time from the presence of the serpent. So what's going on here is the woman goes there and God's protecting her from the attack of the Antichrist, from the attack of Satan. He's protecting her and keeping her in this place. These two verses refer to the same thing. Matthew chapter 24, this is a lengthy portion, hang with me. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. And pray that your flight may not be in the winter or on the Sabbath. For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been seen since the beginning of the world until this time, nor shall ever be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh should be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone says to you, look, here's the Christ, or there, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. God, even in this verse of scripture, we see it. God is protecting his people. He knows what's going on. I'm glad he's in my tomorrow. I'm glad he's already there preparing a place for me. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but he's already there making a way for me. He's already there laying out the path. He's already there calling the shots. Amen. It's good to know that he's on my side. It's good to know that he's protected. It's good to know. Listen, and he said, when you begin to see these things, don't get concerned about the things of this world. One of the One of the saddest scriptures to me is when God sends the angels in to bring Lot out of Sodom. They're warning of the coming destruction. They're telling him of what's going on. And the Bible said that while they were yet speaking, Lot lingered. That's the word of you. Lot lingered. He hesitated. He looked around at his kids. He looked around at his wife. He looked around at all the situation, and he lingered. And the Bible said that the angel of the Lord caught him by the arm and basically dragged him out of the city, him and his wife. But there was something inside of Lot that he was like, I don't know if I want to leave this place. Was the hesitation because he didn't want to leave? Was the hesitation maybe he didn't believe that this really was going to happen? I don't know what the hesitation, but for some reason, Lot lingered. There's a lot of people that have heard this gospel message. They sit in churches, maybe even sitting or listening online, and they're going to linger at the warnings of the coming of Christ. But let me tell you something. Just like that fire and brimstone rang down on Sodom, Jesus is coming again. Those that are dead in Christ are going to rise first. We which are alive and remain are going to be caught up together will be with him. And it's going to happen just like God said at his appointed time. Listen, he's not going to linger. He's not going to tarry. When he deemed it way back in eternity in the beginning for that day to happen, it's going to happen by his clock the exact way that he said it. But the beauty of it is because he cares so much for you and I that we don't fall into deception. The days are going to be shortened that the elect will not be deceived. He loves us, folks. He loves those choice people that are in his, a part of his body. I don't have time. I'm not going to go through the Mark and the Luke rendition of this, but Matthew 24 captures the essence of this. As you begin to see these things happen, don't get concerned. Don't even go back to the field to get close. From the field to get close. Don't get concerned about these things. Focus and look up. Don't lose focus about what's happening in that moment. It's easy for us to get distracted by stuff. And he's saying, don't do that. When you begin to see these things fulfilled, when they're coming to pass right before your eyes, don't get distracted with stuff. God's got a place prepared for you. I don't have to worry about what's going to happen with my furniture. I don't have to worry about what's going to happen with my house. I got a better house. That's not owned by the bank. Glory to God. Come on now. I've got a place. I've got a mansion built for me. I'm going to a place that the Bible said the city whose builder and maker is God. That's where I'm going. So I don't have to get distracted by stuff. There's not anything I'm leaving that I wish I could take with me. There's not anything behind me that I wish would be up. And I'm not worried about it. I just can't wait to behold him and his glory and his presence, his power. More than anything, what I want to know that I've got here on this earth is I want to know my wife made it. I want to know that my kids made it, my family, my church family made it. I want to know that when I get there, we get to rejoice for eternity forever and forevermore. Not that I'm discouraged about anything, but I understand the times. I pick up the phone, and I even called my daughters right before I walked in and was talking to them. I said, y'all going to church, right? Dad, we're trying to get there. There's a wreck on 40, but we're trying to get there. I want my kids, Tracy and I, we kept telling them, don't you get sidetracked up here and fall away from being faithful. You get into church. You get planted. We found them a church. We said, you plant here. I know things might not always work the way you want it, but plant your feet somewhere and get yourself solid and grounded and rooted and get the word in you because the Lord's coming. I don't want my kids getting distracted. I don't want them to get their eyes on this horizontal plane. I don't want them to forget that they got to keep looking up. Amen. He's coming. He's coming. So God prepared that place. Some authors of different versions intimate that this woman fleeing into the wilderness refers to the rapture of the church, which will not occur, they say, until the middle of the tribulation week. I don't believe that. But there's some people that say that. They're saying that at the breaking of the covenant, that's when the church is going to be raptured out. I don't see that in Scripture, but some people try to make that argument. But this is what we reject it because the church must be gone prior to the beginning of the tribulation. Let me make this argument, and then we're going to close this out. They have to be gone before the tribulation. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 7 and 8. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. So when he comes into place, we're getting out of here. It didn't say when he steps in and starts doing his destructions. It just says when he's revealed. So when he takes his place, we're gone. So let's look at look at another scripture. 1 Thessalonians 4, 14 through 18. So if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus shall we always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Back up one verse, please. Look at verse 17. People always say, well, there's no such terminology as rapture in the Bible. There it is right there, caught up together. We're going to be caught up. That's rapture. I know there's people out there, they want to argue theology and all this other stuff. You just take them to this one verse right there and say, if you want to hang around, you hang around. But I'm planning on being caught up. You can call it what you want to call it. You can argue the semantics if you want to. But I got a promise that if I'm not dead when that trumpet sounds, I'm going to be caught up. I got a promise that as long as my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life and I'm washed in his blood and my sins are forgiven, I'm going to be caught up. I'm looking for that day when the trumpet sounds and we get caught up together to be with him and the Lord. Listen, folks, this is why we come together. We comfort one another. We encourage one another. We strengthen one another because there's coming a day that we're going to be caught up. I hope we're all sitting in church together. Just go together. Wouldn't that be awesome? I hope we bust this roof wide open. Leave potholes in it for the next guy. What the world happened here? They went home. I hope there's about 400 holes. Fill this building up with people that want to know the gospel and just potholes going out the door. Amen. And I got a promise that it's going to happen. So the promise is that when he comes into power, I'm gone. Revelation chapter 3, verse 10. He said, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Look what he's saying here. If you do what I'm telling you to do, I'm going to protect you before all that stuff starts happening. I'm getting you out of here. Revelation chapter 4, verse 4. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. So God, listen, God put it all together. He's making the whole picture, and we're going to get to go and worship God before his throne. Wow. Revelation 5, 8 through 10, last verse of scripture. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. So what's this saying? There's a group of people that are going to be there when all this stuff is going on, and they're going to say, hey, we've been redeemed by the blood. As the old song says, there's a song that the angels cannot sing. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. They can't say that, so it ain't angels that's up there saying we've been redeemed. It's God's church that's going to be up there saying we've been redeemed. And we get to be in the presence of God. Listen, folks, this woman flees to the wilderness. She's protected, and her place is protected, and it's put together by God's hand. And God's doing the same thing for us right now. I said it before, and I'll say it one more time. Listen, folks, we're not through chapter 12 yet. We're going to pick up with verse 7 next week, Lord willing. But listen to me. It's been a little over 2,000 years, depending on what calendar you look at, since Jesus ascended. He said, I'm going to prepare a place. Could you imagine what kind of place that's going to look like after 2,000 years of construction and pulling together and making it happen? So if in 6 days God could create all this that leaves us in awe sometimes and things we still haven't discovered, could you imagine 2,000 years? Now, that's our time because 1,000 years is a day and a day is 1,000 years to God. So, you know, it probably feels like yesterday to him up there. But for me, it's been long enough. Come get me, Lord. Let's go home. There's prayers I prayed in ignorance, and I've asked God, please, just take that and throw it out of the bowl. I don't want that one going up before you. I used to pray, God, let me live to be in my 90s and see my grandchildren. I'm thinking, God, come get me now. Forget that prayer. Throw that one away. Rip it up. Throw it on the brazen altar or something. Get rid of it. I don't want it. But, man, I'm praying he come. And quickly, I'm praying he comes. He's a faithful God, folks, and he will fulfill that which he's promised. And I'm glad I'm part of this thing called the church. Not Daystar Church, not Church of God Church, but the church. Because the church is founded on the rock, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. And the promise is, we just saw it through the scripture, is that if we hold on a little bit longer, we're going to see him when he comes. We're going to get to behold him in all his glory. We're going to get to be witnesses of his power and majesty and see him in all of his beauty. Man, that's going to be awesome, ain't it? If you really believe that, you need to find somebody and tell them the story. Somebody that's lost, and let them know he's coming. There was a day that they would walk around the streets and would greet one another, Maranatha. Why? Because they had that anticipation that he's returning. That's what Maranatha means. The Lord is coming. They would greet one another with Maranatha. It's almost like we've become numb to the gospel. We've become numb to the prophecies. We've become numb to the word of God. But I'm telling you, the more I'm studying this book, the more excited I am getting about the coming of the Lord. The more I'm checking myself every day and saying to the Lord, God, I'm sorry if I messed up. Lord, I don't want to miss it. I'm asking God, if I know I've done something I know's wrong, man, I don't sit on that thing. I get before the Lord and say, help me here, God. I need to make this thing right. I need you to make me right. It's not worth it, folks. It's that close. It's absolutely that close. Do you believe it? Amen. Let's be vigilant about God's business. Father, I love you so much. Thank you once again for the power of your word, the power of your gospel. I just pray, Lamb of God, that you'd have your way in our lives and help us, God, to understand the expediency of the time and the season that we're living in. God, to be all you called us to be. Father, we just surrender all that we are to you, God. I give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. Help us, God, to walk through your word and live out your word. Let it be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Help us, God, to keep our focus up, God, because our redemption draweth nigh, and it's nearer than when we first believed. I believe, God, that soon and very soon we're going to behold the King. And, God, I can't wait. Thank you, Lord, for your promise of your word. Thank you, God, for the fulfillment of your word right before our very eyes. And, God, you're going to do exactly what you said you would do. God, we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor for it. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. God bless you guys.